نحمده ونصلي على رسوله الكريم. أما بعد، فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. قل ربي زدني علما. قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم: من يرد الله به خيرا يفقهه في الدين. وإنما أنا قاصر والله يعفي، أو كما قال عليه الصلاة والسلام. Honored Asatiza, respected ulama, students and guests, life is a classroom. من المهدي إلى اللحد، from the cradle to the grave، from beginning till the end، from birth till death. In fact, some scientists are of the opinion that man, in the very womb of his mother, begins the process of learning. Whether that is substantiated by Quran and Hadith is not the issue. The point is that from the very earliest stages of his life till his demise, man is in a continual, perpetual process of absorbing and accumulating knowledge and wisdom. Some of that knowledge is useful, some useless, some of it beneficial, some harmful and destructive. Some of that knowledge acquired is acquired with intent, purpose, intention, consciously, and some of it subconsciously. But whatever form it takes and whatever the nature of that knowledge, the learning process is a continuing one. It is an ongoing one. And fortunate are those individuals who realize that this is a process that does not have a final station. This is a process in which there is not even room for a pause for breath. There is no intermission, no interval, no half-time. This is a soccer game without a half-time or a full-time. This is a book, a long, continuing book without a final chapter. This is a very long sentence, a continuing sentence without an end. And when I use the word sentence, I mean use it metaphorically for the grammatical sentence which starts with a capital letter and ends with a full stop. But I am aware that for many students, the years of study that they spend while they are in madrasa genuinely feels more like a prison sentence. But the acquisition of knowledge is a process that is continuing, a sentence that is a sentence without a full stop. The learned men of this ummah were aware of this and they realized this. That is why we find Imam Abu Yusuf rahmatullah alayh, who the ummah came to know as Qadi al-Qura, moments before his death, is engaged in discussion regarding the Masail of Hajj with Ibn al-Jarrah. Because the learning process is a continuing one and there is no final station, we find eminent scholars of this ummah bidding farewell to the world, saying their final greetings to this temporal domain, clutching pieces of paper with fatawa. This is why we find Allama Anwar Shah Kashmiri rahmatullah, who was an institution, an academic institution of knowledge within himself, when he was afflicted with a severe illness, He was seen immersed and absorbed in the study of books. It was inquired of him, why do you labor yourself such? And why do you exert yourself so? Why do you push yourself in this way? If there was such an urgency to refer to the books, then we were available, we are here for your assistance, and we would have helped you if there was such urgency. He responded by saying, you have a valid point, but, and then pointing to his books, he said, this too is an illness. What am I to do about this illness? He was referring to the desire. And perhaps desire is too weak a word. He was referring to the absolute craving to acquire more knowledge, to increase himself in learning. Just as an alcoholic who is undergoing treatment has irresistible cravings. Just as a drug abuser who is receiving treatment at a rehabilitation center has irresistible urges and temptations, and the old ghosts come and haunt him. And just as an individual who is a chain smoker wishing to kick the habit has irresistible urges, and they often surrender and succumb to those temptations, my dear brothers, the men of learning have irresistible cravings and temptations for knowledge. And they very often gladly succumb to those temptations. It is like an itch that won't go away. As long as you scratch, as long as you scratch, there is relief, there is comfort, there is satisfaction. For these men of learning, as long as they leaf through the pages of a book, as long as they are absorbing information, as long as they are restoring it, analyzing it, understanding it, comprehending it, and applying it, then only is there satisfaction, then only is there calm, then only is there relief, then only is there comfort. It is what the Prophet of Allah in Hadith has referred to as, مَنْ هُمَانِ لَا يَشْبَعَانْ مَنْ هُمٌ فِي الْعِلْ لَا يَشْبَعُ مِنْهُ وَمَنْ هُمٌ فِي الدُّنْيَا لَا يَشْبَعُ مِنْهَا. The Messenger of Allah states in Hadith that there are two forms of greed, of temptation, of these cravings that are never satisfied. مَنْ هُمٌ فِي الْعِلْ لَا يَشْبَعُ مِنْهُ. The Messenger of Allah states that individual who has a craving for knowledge, who has a greed for knowledge, لَا يَشْبَعُ مِنْهُ, he is never satisfied with what he has acquired. He always is urging for more. He always wants to increase his knowledge. وَمَنْ هُمٌ فِي الدُّنْيَا لَا يَشْبَعُ مِنْهَا. And that individual who has greed for the world, who has greed for the material of the world, he is never satisfied with what Allah has given him. He is always greedy for more. He is always craving for more. My dear brothers, the process of learning is a continual one. It is a perpetual one. من المهد إلى اللحد, from the cradle to the grave. And no matter what and how eminent a scholar may be, he may be the leading scholar of his generation, he may be the intellectual of his era, he will always be the incomplete article. He will always be the unfinished product as far as accumulation of knowledge is concerned. And that is the reason why the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the source of all knowledge, the fountainhead of learning and wisdom, the unlettered educator of mankind, the Rasul who said, إِنَّمَا أَنَا قَاسِمْ أَنَا قَاسِمْ, I am the distributor of knowledge. The Rasul who said, إِنَّمَا بُعِثْتُ مُعَلِّمًا, I have been sent as the teacher for the whole of mankind. He, by Allah Azza wa Jalla, is ordered in the Quran, قُلْ رَبِّ زِدْنِي عِلْمًا, say, O Prophet, my Lord, increase me in my knowledge, expand me in my knowledge. If there is only one station of knowledge and one station of learning that is complete, that is perfect, that is comprehensive, and that is the station of divinity. Only Allah can claim, إِنَّ اللَّهَ عَلِيمٌ خَبِيرٌ, verily Allah is all-knowing, He is all-informed, and only Allah can say, وعنده مفاتيح الغيب لا يعلمها إلا هو. And to him belong the keys of the unseen. Nobody is aware of that but he. And only Allah can claim وما تسقط من ورقة إلا يعلمها. And there is not a leaf that falls from a tree but it is in the knowledge of Allah, because he is on the station of infinite knowledge. He is on the station of divinity, and it is the station of divinity that has comprehensive and conclusive and all, he has infinite knowledge. The rest of humanity is deficient. It is incomplete. They must continue the process from the beginning till the end, from the cradle to the grave, because there is no final station of this knowledge. My dear brothers, to acquire knowledge and to acquire learning, there are two forms whereby an individual will acquire this learning. First of all, there is the education that life gives to an individual. That is common to all people. It is a basic knowledge. It is what we refer to as common sense. There is nothing remarkable about common sense. It is an education that life provides to all human beings. In fact, anybody who doesn't possess common sense, and have I met a few of those, that is remarkable, that is astonishing. And there is another education, my dear brothers, that life provides, and that is experience. And experience is not common to all human beings. And the general rule is, the more experienced an individual, the greater will be his wisdom. From an Islamic scholar's point of view, for him to experience working across a whole field of Islamic activities, for him to have sampled and tasted, taking part in, participating in, working in a whole spectrum of Islamic activities, not devoting himself to all those fields, because that's an impossible task. You can't devote yourself to all fields, but just to have sampled and to have experienced. For an alim, for an Islamic scholar, to travel throughout the globe and visit Islamic organizations and institutions and see how they work, see how they operate, see what their methods are, what their processes are, see what their aims and objectives are. For him to travel to Islamic universities and Islamic departments of universities in this country and Islamic universities in the Middle East, in Egypt, in Syria, in Asia, in Malaysia, for him to visit these institutions of learning and to, if possible, acquire some sort of knowledge and take up a course there, for an individual alim to spend time in the company of an eminent scholar, a prestigious scholar, all these experiences are invaluable experiences. An individual who has these experiences is to be envied, because it is through this type of experience that an individual gets insight. He gets vision. He begins to see things from a global perspective. He is not narrow-minded. When he eventually devotes himself to one activity, then when he works in that activity, he will view things from a broader perspective, from a world image. And it will bring a richness of experience to those activities that he is engaged in. And when he forms an opinion, when he makes a judgment about something, that opinion and that judgment will be an informed opinion. When he levels a criticism against anybody, then usually it will not be a criticism that is shot and fired off the hip, as is the habit of many an individual, to fire criticism and opinion that is ill-informed. It is good for an alim, for a man of knowledge, to acquire all these experiences and to have sampled people from different backgrounds who do not share the same history as his own, for him to understand those people, because Islam is not isolated to one small community. It is a global religion. We must view it from a global perspective. The second form of learning is education and learning in a systematic way, with intent and with purpose. Learning that is usually done through conventional means, through books, through reference books, in a systematic, organized way. Planned learning. Learning in a classroom, learning from a blackboard and chalk, learning from the computers, learning from the internet, learning under the supervision of a teacher, learning in the classroom through books and through reference books, through research, through discussion and debate. intended and purposeful learning, that is also an education. My dear brothers, both of these forms of learning and processes of learning, they are both equally important. An alim who has a wealth of knowledge but is lacking in experience, he is incomplete. And an individual who has a wealth of experience but lacks knowledge, then he too is deficient. These two types of learning and these two types of education must be acquired by an individual for him to be a more complete man, for him to be a more complete scholar. These two are not conflicting with one another, they are complementary to one another. And Darul Uloom provides both types of education to a degree, to a level. Darul Uloom provides a formal method of learning in the classroom under the supervision of a teacher through reference books, through textbooks, through reading and writing. And Darul Uloom also provides experiences. An individual, a student, within the 6 years that he spends in the alim course will come across many circumstances and situations and problems. He will have to use his judgment, he will have to use his tact, he will have to overcome problems, he will have to find solutions. So there are many experiences to be had in Darul Uloom. So Darul provides to a degree, to a certain level, both forms of learning and education, but Darul Uloom has never claimed to provide a comprehensive and complete education. Darul Uloom and the education that is provided here is only a small piece in a very large jigsaw. It is only a small piece in the academic life of a scholar. Beyond the Darul Uloom, there are infinite channels of learning. There are vast stores of information. There are oceans of learning and wisdom to be explored. There are universes of education to be probed. Darul Uloom is a small piece, a significant piece, but a small piece in the academic life of an individual. Darul Uloom provides a basic education. It teaches the fundamentals. It equips an individual. It gives him certain skills. It teaches an individual the alphabet of learning. It is up to the student, up to the individual, up to the graduate to take that alphabet of learning and work through the libraries of wisdom and knowledge with that alphabet. Darul Uloom places the key to knowledge in the hand of the student and the graduate. It is up to that student to recognize the value of this key, the worth of this key, and using this key open the treasures of troves of knowledge to himself. Darul Uloom provides an introduction to knowledge. It is the duty of the student to embrace that knowledge, to familiarize himself with it, to acquaint himself with it, to form a lifelong companionship and relationship with that knowledge through thick and thin, in sickness and in health, till death as do part. And I have just quoted some marriage vows there. My dear brothers, for those scholars who have a genuine love for knowledge, and the claims of love are not only on the tips of their tongues and on their lips, but that devotion to knowledge is penetrated within the chambers of their hearts, then they must be willing to marry their books, marry their studies. That the strong relationship must exist between learning and himself. That devotion must be there, that obsession must be there. If I recall correctly, I think it was Maulana Ilyas Rahmatullah Alayh who also went through a period in his life where he was critically ill. And it was taken for granted by the general public that he would not live for much longer. He was sat studying his books. A visitor came and he saw him and he said, "What is the point of your reading? What is the objective in your reading?" The assertion was that you don't have to live for much longer anyway, so why are you bothering to read? Maulana Ilyas Rahmatullah Alayhi replied that you are asking me what is the purpose of my reading. Let me ask you, what if I don't read, what is the purpose of my living? He was living to study. He was devoted to the services of Islam and he was willing to equip himself with all the skills that were necessary in order to fulfill those duties and responsibilities. the former Grand Mufti of Pakistan, the late Mufti Shafi Rahmatullah Alayh, an eminent and prestigious Khalifa of Maulana Ashraf Ali Thanvi Rahmatullah Alayh. And I have heard these words directly from his son, the great scholar Mufti Faqih, may Allah give barakah in his life and work. He said, I often saw my father jump into the back of a rickshaw, and for those few minutes that he would spend traveling in that rickshaw, with the traffic of Karachi swirling around him, and with the noise and the hustle and the bustle of the market all around him, I would see this man sitting in the back of a rickshaw with a pen in his hand, busily scribbling on pieces of paper. He was totally oblivious to what was happening around him. He was immersed in what he was doing. He was devoted. It was an obsession. Only when things become take place to an obsessive degree, then you have genuine progress. Mufti Saqi states that my father used to often call me and my brothers, and he used to tell us that make sure you don't squander your time. Make sure you value every minute of every day, of every week, of every year. And just as somebody weighs gold and silver on scales, making sure that he doesn't waste any of his gold and silver, use your time in the same spirit. And then he will say that I feel embarrassed to say this, but as a lesson to you, I will tell you that when I sit to relieve myself in the toilet, I am so aware of the fact that time is slipping away, and I am so conscious of the fact that the minutes are passing and I am not doing anything useful and constructive. He said, to console myself, I pick up the lota, and if there's any dirt on that lota, if there's anything to be washed away, then I clean that lota to satisfy myself that I'm not wasting my time even while sitting in the toilet. That is devotion and obsession. My dear brothers, people are devoted not to religious sciences, not to the education of religion, but to secular education and knowledge to a degree that is beyond our comprehension. Newton, who is a very renowned scientist amongst the Western world, he was once asked that at such a young age, how did you manage to make so many discoveries? And he replied, and I will not attempt to quote the Latin that he used, but he replied by thinking about it day and night. He had devoted himself to sciences and the knowledge of science to such a level that he had enslaved himself to it. It was on his mind day and night, and that is why he was able to achieve some sort of recognition. When an individual can devote himself, obsess himself, and enslave himself to a knowledge regarding sciences, then we must at least have a little obsession, a little yearning for the knowledge of Nabuwwah and the knowledge of prophethood, my dear brothers. For an Islamic scholar to be effective and influential in the modern day, he needs to be informed about his surroundings. He needs to understand the world he lives in. He needs to be aware of what is happening in society on all levels, on the religious front, on a political level, and generally all the developments and events that occur in society. He needs to be aware of what is happening around him. Fuqaha have long stated, مَنْ جَهِلَ بِأَهْلِ زَمَانِهِ فَهُوَ جَاهِلٌ. An individual who is unaware of the people of his society, who is ill-informed of the practices of the people of his society, who does not understand the environment that he lives in, فَهُوَ جَاهِلٌ, then he is an ignorant man. He may wander the face of the earth with the label of a scholar, but truly he is ignorant. My dear brothers, Imam Muhammad bin Shaybani rahmatullah alayh used to wander into the bazaar, into the towns and the markets, and he used to sit with the merchants and traders, and with his own eyes used to observe what was happening in the market. Not from books, not from second-hand sources, not from third-rate material, directly with his own eye would observe what was happening in the marketplace. How were the transactions carried out? How was business carried out? How were contracts tied up? And once he had observed this, he would return to his home and sit down, and in the light of what he had seen, and with the background information that he had collected, he would derive masail from Quran and Hadith regarding business. Because he was aware of the fact that in order to pass judgment on a people, in order to apply the rulings of Quran and Hadith in a suitable way, in a practical way, in an appropriate way, it was essential to understand the issues. It was important to understand the practices of the people before you ruled them. It is no longer sufficient for us to have the basic knowledge of the masail of Islam, the masail of Tahar, the masail of Salah, the masail of Zakah, the masail of Sawm, the masail of Nikah, Salah. It is no longer sufficient for us to have a grasp of this information. It was never sufficient, but if we were deluding ourselves, then we must wake up to the fact that just to know these basic masails for a scholar is no longer sufficient. He needs to be in touch. He needs to be on the ball. He needs to be aware of what is happening. He needs to have his fingers placed firmly on the pulse of society. He needs to be able to lead events. He must not be led by public opinion and events. He must form public opinion. He must be aware of the changes in lifestyles, the changes in trends in society. And not only must he be aware of the changing trends in society, he must be able to anticipate change before it even occurs. That's how aware he should be. Organize for it, you can put measures into place for it, you can make all the necessary preparations so that when that change does occur, then all the benefits, all the advantages, all the usefulness that is to be reaped from those changes, then the Muslims can take full benefit from those changes, and any harms that are to be posed, and any hazards, and any dangers, and any damages that will be posed by those changes, then we can minimalize those harms. We can limit those dangers, because we've already made the preparations for them. It is useless, my dear brothers, that when the change has occurred, and the damage has been done, and the rot has set in, and then we shed tears, that if only we had done things beforehand, if only we had anticipated beforehand. My dear planning, my dear brothers, planning is before an event occurs, and not after an event occurs. That is why planning is called planning. It's done before an event, and not after an event. We must be able to anticipate change. And the Muslim community as a whole should be so equipped, it should be so skillful, and we must have the support of professionals so that we are able to direct change, mold change, shape change, so that change is not a destructive force, it is a constructive force, it is a useful force. Not all change is harmful, we can direct change if we are skillful and if we are sufficiently equipped, we can make it a constructive force. My dear brothers, I suppose the point I am making is that change is inevitable. It will happen whether we like it or not. But we must be able to shape it, mold it, and direct it so that the Muslim community can take full advantage of those changes and the benefits that are to be derived thereof. And if there are any dangers, then how can we alert the Muslim public to it? How can we raise awareness about those dangers? From beforehand, those things can be done. My dear brothers, the internet is here to stay. By the end of the generation, it will have forced its way into every home in this country. It has many uses for the Muslim society. There are advantages to be taken from it, but it also poses many dangers, not only to the Muslim society, but the whole of the nation and for the whole of the world. There are disadvantages and advantages. How can we reap those advantages, and how can we limit that damage, and how can we create an awareness amongst the Muslim public so they are protected from the harms of the internet? Those things need to be planned from beforehand, before it takes the grasp over the people and the damage has already been done. It is easy, my dear brothers. It is easy to condemn and criticize TV and satellite, and to criticize the use of TV and satellite for the propagation and the promotion of religion. But in the world we live in, when these forces of the media are being used in a devious and very professional way to introduce naive, innocent Muslims to an Islam that we don't recognize, it is fine to condemn those forces, but we must be able to provide an alternative. What are the other options? How can we most effectively counteract the work and the forces of evil if we are to condemn and criticize it? My dear brothers, it is easy to criticize and condemn young Muslim girls who stray out of their home, who have adopted a Western lifestyle, who have adopted a Western culture, who are clubbing and dancing at nightclubs, and who are attending parties, and who are dating boys, Muslim and non-Muslim. It is easy to criticize those young girls. But if we genuinely have any hope of discouraging these young girls from acting in the way that they do and discouraging them from the Western social life, then we must provide a suitable alternative, we must provide a suitable option. It is foolish to believe, it is naive to believe, it is unrealistic to believe that young Muslim women who are thoroughly impressed by the Western culture and by the Western social life, that they will abandon all that, that they will give all that up. For what? In exchange of what? No social life at all? For a non-existent social life? My dear brothers, arrangements need to be made. Schemes need to be put into place whereby Muslim women can enjoy the company of one another, can engage in satisfying, mentally stimulating and engaging activities, and enjoy a full and healthy social life in the strictest definition of Islam. Within the strictest parameters and framework of Islam, when we have provided these alternatives and options, then we can present them. Those who wish to adopt, then let them adopt them. Those who wish to reject, then let them reject them. At least we have fulfilled some sort of responsibility. It is easy, my dear brothers, to condemn those. It is quite convenient to condemn individuals who eat and take interest. But if we have a genuine concern for the welfare of the Muslim society, then we must provide alternatives and other options. My dear brothers, the Muslim Ummah today is not in as much need of fatwa regarding halal and haram as it is in need of practical solutions. I am not suggesting for one moment that the examples that I have given, that those parties who are perpetrating these actions, that they are innocent, they are not guilty, they are not sinful. Verily, a person who takes interest, then that is an action that is prohibited. They are perpetrators of a transgression, and that should be condemned, and it is deplorable, and there is la shakka, there is no doubt it. And I'm not suggesting for one moment that those people who don't provide these alternatives, then they are the guilty party, that they have all the responsibility, that they have the blame on their shoulders. The only point I wish to make is that if we have a genuine concern for the welfare of Muslims, we have a genuine worry for our Muslim brethren, then we must, out of this worry, out of this genuine concern for their welfare, must feel obliged, must feel under an obligation, must feel under some sort of duty to provide these alternatives. My dear brothers, I will just have to very briefly wrap up what I want to say. There were several other points that were more relevant to today's program that I wanted to cover, but if I start on one or two of those points, that may take some time. So I will have to wind up my bayan now. All I can say is, just to conclude, the points I wanted to get to were the fact that a university education is to be recommended highly on certain conditions. The Muslim community is in the urgent need of professionals and specialists. But it is only to be recommended to that on a few conditions. One of the conditions being that the candidate who wishes to take a university degree and wishes to graduate at a university and take up a course, then that individual must be the right candidate. He must have a certain competency. He must have a certain ability. And he must have the correct attitude, the correct temperament. He must be disciplined and he must be self-controlled. Number two, the course that is chosen by a candidate that must be selected and chosen very carefully, so that the course that is undertaken by the individual, it must be one that, having completed it, the person, when he qualifies, when he holds a position, when he holds a profession, when he pursues a career, it is that career which can most effectively serve the Muslim community. And lastly, and most importantly, when an individual acquires these qualifications, the position that he takes up after that, and the office that he holds, that career must not be only for financial security and prosperity. It can be, stress the word only, it can be also for financial security and prosperity, but not only for financial security. The loyalties, the work, the effort, the aim, the objective of that individual must always be to serve the cause of Islam and nothing else. His career must not become the objective. My dear brothers, Maulana Mahmood is to be congratulated. Or rather, should I say, Professor Mahmood is to be congratulated for the effort and the work that he has put in to acquire his doctorate. It takes courage, determination, a pioneering spirit to cross uncharted waters. And that is what he has done, and done it admirably. May Allah Azza wa Jalla accept his efforts, give him barakah in his work, and may he be just the first of many who will pursue this line. جزاكم الله خير وآخر دعوانا الحمد لله رب العالمين.